Hello, this is Dr. Claire. Welcome to the first lecture for Biology 181. Today we're going to be talking about the traits that you can use to recognize a living organism. But this is an introductory biology class, so before we move on to that, we should define what biology is. And biology is the study of life, the study of living organisms, or the study of how life works. But what exactly qualifies as a living organism? Now, we use a number of different traits to identify living organisms and to separate them from non-living organisms. The traits I'm going to talk about today are that life is very complex. You have multiple levels of structure in living organisms, and there's a lot of different processes that are going on within living organisms that make them much more complex than a more static organism, like, say, a rock. There's not a lot going inside of a rock. I mean, some things happen, but it takes a really long time. Living organisms also respond to their environment, so the environment is constantly changing. In order for living organisms to survive, they need to be able to respond to and adapt to whatever changes are happening in the environment. And even organisms that don't really look like they're responding very, very quickly are actually reacting to their environment. All living organisms have the ability to reproduce. They make more of themselves. All living organisms, at least on this planet, have cells. And they use energy, so they have various functions that are happening within the body that take energy, and they need to have energy to use to make those functions go, basically. And all living organisms evolve. So we're going to go through these one by one and kind of talk about each one a little bit. We'll start with complexity. So when you look at a particular organism, there are multiple layers of structure that are going on there. So all matter on this planet, of course, is made up out of molecules and atoms. Not all matter is alive, but when you look at these molecules and atoms, they're arranged in particular ways that make up structures within the cell and make up the cells themselves. Those cells then can be organized into tissues. And then those tissues, in turn, are organized into organs, which are then organized into organ systems, and then into a whole organism. But it doesn't stop there. That whole organism then is part of a population of individuals of the same species. Those populations then are in the same area and form communities of different species. And then on a larger scale, you can look at the ecosystems that these different communities make up. So, at each level of organization, there are traits that emerge that can't be predicted by the lower levels of organization. So you can know a lot about molecules, but just by understanding molecules, you can't understand exactly how a cell is going to work. This is called emergent properties. So but you can understand a ton about a cell, but unless you understand how the different cells within a tissue interact, you don't really understand that tissue. So these levels of complexity are really important for understanding all of the traits that come out of living organisms. Now you may be saying, okay, yes, an elephant is a complex organism, but some organisms are really simple. So like a bacteria, that's a one-celled organism. It seems pretty simple. But if you look at the cellular level, there's a lot of stuff going on even in a single cell. This illustration here is a diagram of cell signaling, which basically is a way that a cell can react to its environment. It picks up signals from the outside of the cell. This is the cell membrane here. And those signals are then passed through a number of molecules within the cell to trigger expression of different genes within the cell. So obviously, there's a lot of complexity here in this particular diagram. So there's, even on a very small scale, we have a lot of complexity. All right, organisms respond to their environment. So obviously if you have, say, a bird and it becomes winter, it's time for that bird to migrate south for the winter. It's responding to the changes in the day length and the temperature declining and reduction of food resources to trigger in it this behavior to go to another location where it can survive. And so in animals, it's pretty easy to see how they respond to their environment. And some other organisms may not be as clear, but take something like a sunflower. The sunflower responds to its environment on a daily basis by having the blossom of the flower track the sun across the sky. And so you can actually see that happening on a small scale. On a larger scale, plants will grow towards light. They'll bend around objects that are preventing them from growing. And all of that is responses to the environment. So responding to the environment is really important for survival. All cells use energy. All life uses energy. The energy has to come from somewhere. In general, there are two major sources where energy can come from in a living organism. It can come from the sun, or it can come from the food source for the organism. So things like plants and algae, they're actually harvesting energy from sunlight and turning that into chemical energy that they can then use to do things in the cell. They turn it into a sugar, and then they can break down that sugar and use the energy in those chemical bonds to do things like make new molecules, grow, reproduce, things like that. Animals, of course, can't capture energy from the sun in that same way. So they have to get their energy from their food. So they consume other organisms and then use the molecules within those other organisms to harvest energy and then use that to do things like grow, make new cells, heal themselves, do all those different things that living creatures do. And one important thing to remember is the first law of thermodynamics. That means that energy can neither be created nor destroyed. So if an organism needs to do something, the living thing needs to do something, it needs to create a new protein. The energy to make that protein has to come from somewhere. You can't just make that protein in the absence of energy. So there has to be some input of energy into the system to create that complexity. Generally, these transformation processes, turning energy from one form, from sunlight form into a sugar, or from a sugar into chemical energy that you can use to build new molecules, is not a completely efficient process. There's usually some amount of energy that's lost as heat, and so you do tend to see a reduction in energy as you go up the food chain and things like that. We'll talk about more when we get to ecology, okay? All organisms reproduce. They make more of themselves. They don't just spontaneously arise. So something like a bacterium, it's going to just divide itself in two, and that's how it makes more of itself. So you have one bacteria cell, and it divides, and then you have two, and those both divide, and you can have four, and you have really rapid reproduction. More complex organisms tend to reproduce sexually, like this mallard duck here. This mallard duck has mated with a male mallard duck and produce a whole bunch of little ducklings. But in any case, they produce more of a similar species that's genetically similar to themselves. This wasn't always completely clear to people, though. Historically speaking, sometimes people didn't know where living organisms came from. Like, they would have a piece of meat, and then one day they would come and they would find that there were maggots all over the meat. Or they would have a pile of hay in their barn, and they would find that, oh, that pile of hay is now full of mice. And they thought that these food sources could spontaneously generate living organisms by their simple presence. This is an early experiment that demonstrated that life only comes from other life, that living organisms have to be produced by living organisms of the same type. It was an experiment where they had meat that they allowed to go bad, and flies like to lay their eggs on meat. And so originally, this is one of those hypotheses that humans had historically, was that rotting meat would spontaneously generate flies. But actually, that's not what's happening. What's happening is those flies are landing on the meat, laying their eggs, and then the maggots hatch out of the egg. And while the maggots may not become visible while the flies are actually there, the flies have to get to the meat for those maggots to be there. They can't just spontaneously appear. And they were able to demonstrate this by having different jars, that one where flies could actually access meat, one where there was a mesh cover so air could get in and out, but the flies couldn't get in and out, and one with an actual tight cover that didn't even allow for air exchange. And only in the jars where flies could actually access the meat did you see the appearance of maggots. And so this was one of these demonstrations historically that showed that that life has to come from other life. It doesn't just spontaneously arise. All right, all living organisms, at least on this planet, are made up out of cells. So that's everything from bacteria to plants to algae to animals to our very own selves. So some living organisms are a single cell, but many are multicellular, have multiple different cells and multiple different cell types. So let's talk a little bit about the characteristics of cells, just so that we are on the same page. We're not going to talk about cells a lot in this course. That's something you're going to get more in 182 than in 181. But just a few things about cells. All cells contain information that will allow for reproduction. All right. So that's in the form, in life on this planet, that's in the form of DNA. So you have cells, they contain DNA. That DNA stores the information to make every single thing that you need to make that cell. So it creates proteins, or well, DNA is transcribed into RNA, and then that RNA is transcribed to make proteins. And those proteins then make up the whole structure of the cell. And then various of those proteins will catalyze different chemical reactions and allow the cell to actually function. So you have to have that DNA. And that DNA is passed on from generation to generation, and that's how you have similarities between generations. So all cells have this store of information in the form of DNA. All cells also have a plasma membrane. So they have this a lipid bilayer. It's a fatty layer, very thin. It's like basically two fat molecules that are sitting with their little fatty tails down like this. And that keeps the cell separate from its environment. So it keeps the stuff that's supposed to be inside the cell in, and the stuff that's supposed to be outside the cell out. And that's one of the ways that you can recognize a cell. So in this little diagram here, this is an image of the cell membrane. So you can see that bilayer, that lipid bilayer there. There's two little lines. And this whole big cell here is surrounded by that plasma membrane. In many cells, there are also structures, additional structures that have membranes within the cell. Not all cells have that, but all cells have that outer cell membrane. Okay? All right, so cell theory is actually another one of these historical processes. So after they discovered that organisms, like animals, only come from other animals, they also had to figure out whether cells could spontaneously arise. And you may have heard of Louis Pasteur. He kind of developed this experiment to demonstrate that even single cells cannot spontaneously arise, that they have to come from other single cells. And the way he did that was by taking essentially chicken broth, and you boil that sterilizes it so that there's no living things in the chicken broth, right? And then they realized that if you leave that chicken broth out, that quickly it would become cloudy, it would start to stink, and that's because there's bacteria that have colonized that chicken broth and are feeding off of it, okay? But Pasteur created this type of flask with a swan neck. And what the swan neck flask does is that it allows air to get into the chicken broth, but not, I mean, it doesn't, it can move, the air can move, but very slowly. And because of the shape, those bacteria, which are present everywhere, there are bacteria just floating around in the air at all times, but they can't float up that curved-necked flask. So they come down the beginning, and then they kind of settle in a little skim of bacteria at the bottom of the curve, and although the air can pass up and go over, the bacteria can't float up and go over. And so what Pasteur discovered is that in that scenario where you had that curved-necked flask that prevented those particles that contain bacteria to get up into the broth would remain sterile. So even though it would be a really great place for bacteria to live, they can't spontaneously appear there. They have to get in there some way and then reproduce once they're there in order to spoil the broth. All right, and then the last trait I'm going to talk about is evolution. So living organisms evolve. So what that means is that they change over time. And I'm going to use a very specific definition of evolution for this class, and I would like you guys to learn this. Evolution is the genetic change in a population over time. There's four components there. There's genetic, change, population, and time. And they're all important. A population can change. So for example, a grass that is unlucky enough to live in my front yard, which I do not water sufficiently, earlier this summer would have been very small. And so I had a whole population of very small grasses in my front lawn. Then we had this really rainy period in August. There was a lot of water, and all of those grasses then grew. So that's change over time. The grasses were small, now they're big. But the genetic composition of that population of grasses has not changed. It's the same grasses that were there at the beginning of the summer. They just grew. So that's not evolution. It's change over time, but it's not evolution because it's not genetic change. So it has to be a genetic change. It has to be a change in the genetic composition of that population. So there has to be some sort of changing in the allele frequencies, and we'll talk more about the different definitions of genetic terms, but some sort of changing in the genetic composition of the population over a long period of time. So that's the definition that I want you to know. So just put that in your heads. So we have lots and lots of evidence that organisms on this planet change over time. I've got a couple of illustrations here. We have a fantastic fossil record of the evolution of horses on this planet, from a very small shrub-eating forest creature up through various intermediate stages to the modern horse that we know today that is a plains grass-eating organism. So quite different from the small shrub creatures that they evolved from. You can also look at things like plants. Plants are related to each other in various ways that are connected by common ancestors that they evolved from. So the ancestral plant was something kind of like a green algae, and then various lineages of plants have branched off of that. So you can see the different changes in those over time as well. Okay, that's all I have for this particular section. I hope you enjoyed it, and I will see you for the next one.